I'd like to introduce Professor Keshab Parhi. And Keshab Parhi is a distinguished McKnight University Professor, Edgar F. Johnson Professor in the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering at University of Minnesota. And I personally know Professor Parhi from his extensive, impressive work on data flow computations and other formal computing theory for digital signal processing systems. He currently works on classification of biomedical signals and images, for example, such as seizure prediction and detection and brain connectivity, both very exciting areas. And his numerous awards include being fellow of the IEEE, recipient of the 2012 DeSoer Technical Achievement Award, 2004 Fred Terman Award, 2003 Tomiyasu Technical Field Award, 2001 IEEE Baker Prize Award, Prize Paper Award, and the 2000 Golden Jubilee Award. So it gives me great pleasure for a colloquium today to introduce our speaker, who will be talking about brain biomedical and biomolecular informatics convergence of signal processing, machine learning, and computing, Keshab Parhi.
Thank you, Les, for the kind introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here, to be back after after a long time that I think many decades. So thank you for inviting me, and it's a great pleasure on my part. So my talk today is going to be on a number of things, as the long title suggests. Part of it is going to be on brain signal processing and brain connectivity, and part of that will be on signal processing for ophthalmology. And the last part, I'm going to talk about molecular computing, DNA computing, and in particular, implementing things like digital filters and fast Fourier transforms in test tubes through the DNA strands. So, and the goal of all of this, the theme that unites all these topics, is we are interested in informatics, machine learning and informatics, borrowing tools and techniques from signal processing and machine learning. So this is kind of a brief overview of what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about a number of biomedical applications with respect to neurology, and I have collaborators in neurology, and we are looking at the imaging modality of EEG on the scalp, EEG on the cap on your head, or the intracranial EEG to predict and detect epilepsy. I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about number of problems from my collaborators in psychiatry who have been working on designing biomarkers and machine learning classifiers for identifying schizophrenia from the magnetoencephalogram and identifying borderline personality disorder from functional MRI and obsessive compulsive disorder from functional MRI. And then I'll talk about the collaborators from ophthalmology, where the goal is to grade fundus images, which are images of the eye, and OCT images to detect and grade diabetic retinopathy, such as grade 0, 1, 2, 3. That means no diabetic retinopathy, mild DR, moderate, and severe diabetic retinopathy. And the last topic I'm going to talk about, how these ideas from computing can be applied to molecular computing and DNA computing to implement informatic systems, in particular artificial neural networks and signal processing operations. So the those are kind of the applications. On the right-hand side, and there are a few tools. There is a DSP. DSP is so-called feature extraction. We may be extracting features in the time domain or in the spectral domain. And there is also a lot of pre- and post-processing, DSP-based pre- and post-processing, even before extracting features or after. After extracting features, or even after the classifier computes a decision, then we could be doing some post-processing on that. The machine learning, the key ideas here are, how do we select features? We may have thousands of features, but we need to select a few that are identifying the disease or the decision that we are trying to make. So how do you select features? And that's kind of ranking the features. That's an important part of these machine learning systems. And then finally, with so many classifiers, like linear classifiers, non-linear classifiers, once again, the process of designing classifiers for these biomarkers is in itself an important goal. And The process of selecting features and classification, these are not two distinct steps, but these are rather integrated steps. A feature that works well in a classifier might not be the best feature for a different classifier. So these two have to work together. And then computing, I'm not going to talk a lot about computing today in this talk, but there is tremendous interest, and we are doing a lot of work on, okay, we have identified these features and the classifiers. How do we compute them and implement them in IC chips so that they compute less energy? So VLSI architectures in particular with the goal of reducing energy consumption of these devices so the battery lasts longer is one of the goals, but unfortunately I won't have time to talk about those things. And then the last part is going to talk about different coding schemes, and in particular we are going to look at molecular computing or DNA computing, where the so-called time series can be thought of as a discrete time series with the concentrations of the DNA strand, which are not discretized or quantized into binary bits, but rather stay with analog concentration. And with that, we are going to look at a few different types of coding schemes. We'll look at binary coding and fractional coding. And fractional coding is a type of coding scheme that is inspired by a new form of computing called stochastic computing. And it so happens that there is a synergy between stochastic computing and fractional coding. And that means any nice stochastic computing design can be the basis of a new molecular computing or a DNA computing design. So we are going to talk about that synergy and how borrowing ideas from one field and apply that in a different field can lead to unexpected outcomes. Okay, so neurological disorders are diseases of the central and peripheral nervous system. These affect hundreds of millions of people. There are more than 600 neurologic diseases. And there are a few listed here, Huntington's disease, muscular dystrophy, but the some of the two most important ones are epilepsy, and that's one of the things we are going to look at, the stroke. So stroke is the most common disease among all neurological disorders, and epilepsy is the second most common disease among these disorders. So I'm going to talk more about epilepsy today, but there are also other diseases like Parkinson's and Alzheimer's. So we look at epilepsy in this talk, and let me just briefly talk about different types of psychiatric disorders. The mental disorders appear primarily as abnormalities of thought, feeling, or behavior, producing either distress or impairment of function. Individuals who have a mental illness do not necessarily look like they are sick. And according to NIH, this slide is taken from NIH, the NIH website states that among adult Americans, that is aged 18 or older, about a quarter of that population suffer from a diagnosable mental disorder in a given year. And there are no objective tests to diagnose mental illness. And some common types of disorders are mood disorders, major depressive disorder, MDD, and I have a collaborator working on adolescent major depressive disorder. She is collecting data on adolescents who are 12 to 19 year olds. Bipolar disorder, suicide, anxiety disorder, obsessive compulsive disorder, and I'm going to talk briefly about that. And this is PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. I'm going to talk briefly about schizophrenia as well. And then finally, borderline personality disorder and antisocial personality disorder. So these are very hard to identify, and these people don't certainly look sick. So the imaging techniques with respect to the neuropsychiatric disorders, we are going to look at the EEG, and EEG both on scalp as on the top left plot here, the person wearing the cap, or on the intracranial EEG that can be implanted in somebody's brain, and the intracranial EEG then can be used to predict when somebody might have a seizure, for example, and then have a therapy delivered by neurostimulation. The neurostimulation could be through the DBS, deep brain stimulation, or through another delivery system. And intracranial EEG could be used to treat and personalize therapy for other diseases like Parkinson's as well. So there are other modalities that we will look at, the MEG, the magnetoencephalogram, so that's the bottom left side, person sitting below the magnet and collecting the magnetoencephalogram data. Then we can analyze those as well through the spectral domain analysis and looking at different band powers and how the band powers might lead to some identification and correlation with schizophrenia in this example. And there are functional MRI as well as structural and diffusion MRI, and the person going into the MRI machine that is shown on the right-hand side on the top, and we can collect the data and we can get different types of imaging modalities, the structural T1 and T2 images and the functional and diffusion images. So I'm going to today talk mostly about functional MRI, but we have been doing some work on diffusion MRI as well with respect to anatomical connectivity. The functional MRI tells us what is going on with respect to functional connectivity. And then there is interest in, and we have been looking at joint connectivity, where we can combine the modalities of anatomical and functional as well. Okay, so neuromodulation is one of the key technologies today to design therapies and treat people. So brain stimulation therapies involve activating or touching the brain directly with a number of approaches. So we can certainly modulate the brain by charge, which is really electricity. Electricity leads to current, and current is a form of charge. It could also be by magnet. Magnet then induces an electric current, which ultimately achieves the same thing. And there is a vagus nerve stimulation, which is another electrical stimulation. And there is a DBS. DBS is either based on voltage or current, but ultimately they are both leading to some form of modulation by electrical means or magnetic means. So transcranial magnetic stimulation, TMS, is very popular because that's non-invasive. The DBS is very invasive, and the electroconvulsive therapy is non-invasive, but you do that through electrical stimulation to the brain. So there are other ways of stimulating the brain as opposed to having the battery inside the implantable device. You can have wireless neural stimulating system where the transcutaneous power and data transmission that is shown, the coil outside can then charge the battery and you get power through the inductive coupling. So you can wirelessly do neural stimulation. This is a slide from my colleague Meisam Gopanlu at Georgia Tech. I have talked about stimulating through the charge and through the magnet, but optogenetics is yet another way where you can stimulate the brain through light. So there is light, there is magnet, there is electricity, and last but not the least, there is also ultrasound and sound. You can stimulate the brain by sound as well. So all of these means, neurostimulation through one or more of these schemes has become very popular today in the field of neuroscience, where the neuroscientists are looking at finding out which, really understanding the brain through these different types of modulation schemes. So the objectives of what we are trying to do, we are collecting data from our collaborators, and we are trying to explore spectral, temporal, spatial biomarkers for these neurological and psychiatric disorders from the neuroimaging data. So we want to gain knowledge about brain disease. We want to design effective therapy and assess the effectiveness of therapy. So if we know the baseline, the brain should look like that, and then you deliver a therapy, the connectivity has come back to what it should be, then we know that the therapy is effective. So by looking at these biomarkers, not just to predict the onset of the disease, but to study the effectiveness of therapy and then design therapy in such a way, in a personalized manner, that's more effective for that person. So these biomarkers can then be personalized as well. So those are kind of the goals. We are trying to classify brain state using machine learning approaches. and some examples that I will go through, detecting and predicting neurological diseases like epilepsy and psychiatric disorders like borderline personality disorder and schizophrenia. So we are also interested in the brain connectivity. The brain, after all, is a network. So if we divide the brain into different regions, 90 regions or 120 regions, then we can understand, just like a network flow, a network science is well understood in communication networks, in computer networks, and we can try to understand the communication inside the brain and how these connectivities are changing from healthy brain to brains with mental disorders. And that's something I will talk about as well. Okay, so let me start with predicting epilepsy from the intracranial as well as scalp electroencephalogram. Epilepsy is the second most common neurological disorder. It affects approximately 1% of the population, nearly 3 million Americans. One third of these people spontaneously recover. One third are successfully treated with anti-epileptic drugs. And the remaining one third have intractable seizures. And some of them cannot be treated with surgery, so-called 40% inoperable, because it so happens the focus of the seizure is at locations which you don't want to operate on. Either person can't speak or can't move. Then out of the remaining 60%, 40% are successfully treated with surgery and 20% continue to have epilepsy even after surgery. So the direct costs for treating subjects with epilepsy is quite a lot. This is 10-year-old statistics that quotes $15 billion in direct and indirect costs, and the number is similar in the European Union. Instead of $15 billion, that's 15 billion euro. So there is a lot of interest in many companies. Medtronic is one example, which tried to have a DBS device approved in the United States for treating epilepsy, and they were not approved. They're going back for a second time to FDA for approval. They have been approved to treat epilepsy with the DBS in the European Union. So seizure prediction device can predict the onset of the seizure from intracranial EEG, and it can provide warning. The warning then can lead to what is known as a closed loop neuromodulation. Even the Medtronic DBS that is approved in European Union now has a form of open loop neuromodulation. That means you keep modulating the brain periodically without any closed loop. That means the idea of closed loop, if you can predict something might happen, then you modulate the brain. So instead of modulating the brain many, many times, which has a lot of side effects, then you can then predict when something might happen and then modulate the brain. That will reduce the side effect due to neuromodulation, due to open loop neuromodulation a lot. This can allow for rescue therapy, must work in real time in implantable devices, should have less power consumption. Few features, simple classifier, those are kind of the goals. The slide here shows the two types of data sets. The right hand side shows the electrode placement on pediatric population from the MIT PhysioNet database, where they have 22 subjects, 22 children at the MGH who were going through this pre-surgical evaluation in the clinic. The left-hand side shows the University of Freiburg database where once again during, so by the way, the right-hand side shows the placement, and the data was collected for 2 days. Each of these subjects had data collected for 2 days. On the left-hand side, data was collected for longer. These were intracranial EEG, but the data that was made available to the community through the University of Freiburg was only 1 day, 24 hours intracranial EEG. So there is intracranial as well as a scalp EEG, and we will look at some of those. The patient-specific algorithm and that can reliably predict seizures with low complexity, that has to be done by classifying. And so if you look at these blue lines, so the blue is called interictal or baseline. So there is nothing going on. That's the baseline state, and there is a green, a brief period of green, about a minute, maybe minute and a half, when the person goes through so-called ictal state, or the person seizes, seizing state, and then just before that minute, minute and a half, that small purple part is the so-called pre-ictal, just before seizure happens. And there is 30 minute post-ictal, right after the person has gone through the seizing state, and then back to interictal. So the purpose of, there are two types of problems. One is called detecting seizures, where we take two classes of data, the green data and the blue data, and then classify them as green or blue, which means ictal or interictal. So that's called the seizure detection problem. The seizure prediction problem then takes the purple data and the blue data, so it predicts interictal or preictal just before seizure happens. I'm going to talk about preictal because that's more important for predicting for closed loop neuromodulation. So the first work we started a long time back, maybe 7 years ago, we started to look at how we can predict seizures using band power, and this band power in 9 different bands, the so-called delta band, theta band, alpha band, beta band, gamma band, and the gamma, which is 30 hertz and higher, was divided into 4 sub-bands, gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, gamma 4, and the total power spectral density. So those were 9 features for one electrode, times in case of the Freiberg database, there were 6 electrodes, the 3 in blue and 3 in red, the 6 electrodes. The red ones are the focal electrodes, so-called in focus, and the blue electrodes are the out of focus. So 9 times 6, we took 54 features, passed them through a support vector machine, and we showed that the 18 subjects out of the 21 patients who had more than 3 or more seizures, we could then use support vector machines to predict seizures. And this is the first, I would say, this was the paper we published in Epilepsy with my colleagues and students in October 2011, was the very first paper of its kind to rigorously apply machine learning to show that we can predict seizures. And in this particular paper we showed, we can predict 77 out of 80 seizures in these 18 subjects, which sounds like a good result, and it is a good result because it was the first time we used all kinds of rigorous machine learning with respect to double cross validation, leave one out, the features that are being tested were generated by training seizures, and then on the test set, we had not used the test data for computing feature selection and so on. So it was completely rigorous machine learning, separating training and test data sets. But the bad news is that the false positive rate was 1 in 4 hours. So that was not very good because although we were able to achieve high sensitivity, it came at a cost of a high false positive rate. So we began to look at how we can simplify that process. And by the way, the number of support vectors were more like 1,000, 2,000, 5,000. And when you were using 5,000 support vectors with radial basis function, that's not something you want to implement in somebody's brain because the cost of computing that and the energy consumption is going to be so much higher. So we tried to understand how can we get a very small number of features and small number of electrodes that would be energy efficient. And we came up with this so-called ratio feature idea, which says that instead of looking at the band powers as features, if we look at the ratios of band power, those are highly efficient features with respect to discriminating preictal versus interictal. And if you look at those 3 vertical bars, which represent the onset of seizures, and if you look at the so-called gamma 2 band, which is 50 to 70 hertz band power, by itself from the top plot, we can see that, well, it probably can predict the middle seizure. The gamma 1 power, which is 30 to 50 hertz, probably could predict second and third. But if we take a ratio of the band power of the 50 to 70 hertz band divided by the power in 30 to 50 hertz band, then we can see we can predict all three. And what is going on is the, if you look at the first seizure there, the gamma one, the gamma two power is going up a little, and gamma one is going down a lot. So we can then amplify that effect. Second one is okay. For the third one, gamma two and gamma one are both going down, but gamma one power is going down a lot more, even though both are going down, and each one of them individually may not be able to discriminate anything, but the ratio is amplified because the denominator slope is a lot more than the numerator slope. So by taking these ratios, we can then predict seizures using very few features. In fact, the paper that was published in Transactions on Biomedical Circuits and Systems, we showed that out of the 18 subjects that I talked about in the Freiburg database, something like the 12 subjects on the left-hand tables, out of 18, for 12 subjects, we can predict 100% seizures using one electrode, one spectral power, not 54 features from six electrodes. And each time you increase the number of electrodes, you have to sense more. There is A to D, there is D to A, and all those things involved. We are saving in power in that as well. And what is more important is the false positive rate. The average false positive rate is now about 0.03. That's about 1 in 30 hours as opposed to 1 in 4 hours. So as simple as the idea may seem, the power of that ratio feature is quite significant in predicting change of brain state. Not just for epilepsy, but as I will go into other topics, we will see that some band powers increasing and some decreasing, we can then capture those effects by ratio features. And for those other subjects that we can't use one feature and one ratio, we can use more. In the case of patient 5, we need two electrodes and total of six features from two electrodes to get 100% sensitivity and the false positive rate once again of 1 in 25 hours or 1 per day. And the last column lists the seizure prediction horizon in minutes, the max and mean in those numbers. Okay, so this is the same kinds of thing from the scalp EEG as opposed to intracranial, and once again the results are very encouraging, so I won't talk about that. So inspired by that ratio feature, we tried to apply that to the magnetoencephalogram to analyze some schizophrenia data. So in schizophrenia is a chronic, complex, severe mental illness. We were looking at language task. Language disorder is a core symptom. Current schizophrenia diagnosis depends on self-reported experiences and clinical observations. So it is highly desirable to explore quantitative and interpretable brain signal patterns to help in assisting in clinical diagnosis, and more importantly, to gain insight into the physiological basis of the disease itself. So this particular study with my collaborator, Dr. Stefan, who has moved to Indiana University, he was collecting data from 12 schizophrenic patients, 10 healthy control during word processing. So the objective was to say certain words and certain words that are certain sounds that are not words. In case of similar task under sentence, there was a sentence like the boy ate a bagel and then the bagel ate the boy. So there were sentences, some of them meaningful and some of them not meaningful. And there was also language task under so-called discourse or paragraph. So for example, my furnace has gone bad, I need to get a plumber. And some things that make sense and some things don't. And how the brain decodes those things were analyzed through the magnetoencephalogram. Anyway, this is a paper that's published recently in Transactions on Neural Systems and Rehabilitation Engineering. This data was collected at the Minneapolis VA Medical Center. So I talked about the language task. There was 3 seconds of baseline, 5 seconds of encoding the word or sentence task, and then 3.5 seconds of post-stimuli. So we tried to understand if there are similar ratio features, some power going up and some power going down, and both during the band power and the window power. So let me just show a few. So in this particular plot, we are showing the middle right frontal region of the brain. And if you look at the power spectral density plotted here with respect to different frequency bands, and the theta over delta band, the theta band power, the patient has a lot more power in the theta band and less power in the delta band. So the theta over delta power is amplified and very high for the patient group as opposed to control group. And that's also visible from the scatter plot. And by the way, these kinds of features were chosen through feature selection process using minimal redundancy, maximal relevance, MR feature selection process. This one shows the middle parietal region of the brain and the band power ratio alpha band over delta band. So if you look at the alpha band, patient group has higher alpha band and the delta band has patient group has lower. So once again, the numerator over denominator, the patient group has a lot higher ratio than the control group. And similar observation here from the beta band over the delta band from the middle frontal parietal region of the brain. So using these kinds of features that we have selected, we were able to show that in this data set, we can achieve 95% accuracy with respect to classifying schizophrenia from the magnetoencephalogram data. So I'm going to talk about functional connectivity of the brain and functional MRI. So graph theory is a well-known technique, and graph theory in brain network is also a very well-known and well-established technique. So human brain is a complex system. Information transfer is made through the combined interaction of neurons and samples of neurons and larger scale brain regions. And graph theory analysis provides a framework for characterizing the topological organization of the brain. We can look at single region analysis. So we can look at, once again, the power in a single region or power spectral density in a band, the magnitude spectrum. We can also do bivariate analysis, where we can look at two regions in the pairwise connectivity. We can compute the correlation coefficient among two time series of two different regions. And then we can look at the network as a whole, where we are not limited to univariate or bivariate analysis, but we look at many regions at the same time. So in this particular study, with data collected from the former head of psychiatry at the University of Minnesota, Dr. Saltz, he was collecting data from the borderline personality disorder for healthy versus BPD. And this paper that was published in March 2016 in Neuroimage Clinical, we were able to show a number of brain topological differences based on functional MRI in healthy brain versus brain with BPD. So let me go to a few. So this is the flow of the analysis. So we collect the functional MRI time series. We go through wavelet filtering to four different bands. We compute the correlation coefficient of each time series in each band. And if you think about four filtered signals, we will compute four different graphs, one in each band. And the pairs and correlation coefficients are, the magnitude of the correlation coefficient is thresholded to get binary graphs. The binary graph is one or zero, the edge exists or does not, and then we do a network analysis on that, and we do a statistical test, and we try to understand if a certain feature is statistically significant or not. So that's kind of the flow of the algorithm. So let me just point out a few. The paper is long, and I won't go through all of them, but a few that I can point out. One is, so there are a number of scatter plots. The first one is the size of the largest connected component. And if you look at that size of largest connected component, this was a 90, I think this was 82 regions, 82 time series. So 82 regions. So if we take this 82 region network and try to understand what is the single largest connected component in that network, and then the scatter plot here shows that the subjects with BPD have a lot more number of nodes in the single largest connected component than the healthy brain. So that came as kind of a surprise to us, because we would have thought that the healthy brain has a lot more communication. In contrast, we are seeing here a lot more communication in the single largest connected component in the BPD. And so while that came as a surprise and we began thinking about why that might be the case, and in fact, as I thought more, at least to me, it made more sense that maybe there is a lot more communication going on in the brain of the BPD. Perhaps that's undesired communication that might be suicidal thoughts or might be some undesired or unhealthy communication that's not going through the healthy brain. So that kind of made some sense. These are regions found to be discriminatory based on p-value. I won't talk a lot about that. But let me talk briefly about this kind of how the brain network is altered. So think about on the left-hand side, I have this big node called A that is connected to these four different other nodes. So if you think about the degree of that node, that degree is 4. So the size of the node, think about the size of the node as corresponding to the hub-like property. If you think about, the hub is, it's a big hub if there are many nodes, many edges coming out of that node. So if you think about Chicago is an airport which is a bigger hub than Duluth Airport in Minnesota, for example. So if you take that left example that I'm showing here and disconnect two of those, the blue nodes on the left and right, you disconnect them and connect them to the node marked B. So B is now a big hub which has a degree fan out of 3, and the red node A has become a small hub because it has lost two of its connections. So if you look at left side of the brain and the right side of the brain and think about the size of the ball as how important that node is as a hub. That's the hubness property of the node. And the green nodes are same for both healthy brain and BPD brain. But if you look at the blue nodes which are big become small hub-like property in the BPD brain. And if you take a look at the red nodes, which are small in the healthy brain, they become big hubs in BPD brain. So in some sense, a lot of connectivity is altered from the healthy brain to the BPD brain. And that's something we learned through this data-driven neuroscience exercise. And then we tried to look at, okay, we had done some kind of thresholding and some kind of analysis with respect to the network, and now in this case, we are looking at a network-based statistic. So each and every correlation coefficient, so this is about 80 nodes total, that means there are 80 choose 2, so that's about 3,000 edges, and we go through a t-test for each and every edge, and we find out about 50 or so edges that are most discriminative between the healthy brain and the BPD brain. And using this t-test, we have this sub-network or the network-based statistic. And then if we look at, these edges are strong edges that discriminate between the healthy brain and BPD. And then we take the average connectivity in these 40 or 50 edges, and we indeed observe that the control group has a lot more functional connectivity than the BPD, and that makes sense because now we are looking at strong links, strong communication with respect to strong or healthy communication. The control group indeed has a lot more mean connectivity than the BPD group. So those are kinds of things that we are learning through analyzing the differences, and we also went through some classifier design, and we can get 90% sensitivity, 70% specificity, and accuracy of about 5/6. So we are going through similar analysis with obsessive compulsive disorder in adolescent groups. This is data collected by another psychiatrist, Dr. Bernstein, and this is a paper we published in a recent EMBC conference. So going through that kind of similar kind of analysis, we tried to find out what are the edges that can be discriminatory between the OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder, and the healthy group. And we see that in this case, we found out 5 by the ranking of these. We found 5 edges that can be discriminatory. And two of those edges were previously published to be discriminatory between OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder, and the healthy group. And we found three more that have never been published in the neuropsychiatry community. So we are validating what is known out there from past experiments, and we are also finding a new base of knowledge that have not been published before. Okay, let me go to the next part of ophthalmic fundus image analysis. So we looked at how to analyze the fundus images and grade them with respect to the diabetic retinopathy. So the idea here was that instead of going to a specialist, which is an ophthalmologist, who is very busy, and you have to wait months to get an appointment, the primary clinician might use such a tool to flag those subjects that should be seen by an ophthalmologist. And if not treated, these people would go blind. So images of the interior surface of the eye, opposite the lens, pathology causing acquired blindness, these could be non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy, proliferative diabetic retinopathy, glaucoma and age-related macular degeneration and so on. So in a paper that we published in the Journal of Biomedical and Health Informatics, we showed that we can grade these images with 100% sensitivity, but with still, unfortunately, about 54% specificity. So while this was a very nice piece of result published at that time, there is still a lot more to do. So we have tools to take these images and take those patches and classify them, whether the patch is a lesion or not. If it is, whether it is a bright lesion or a red lesion. If it is a bright lesion, then that's not very dangerous. If it is a red lesion, such as a hemorrhage or microaneurysm, those the number of those things impacts the grade of the diabetic retinopathy. So we can then grade by counting how many hemorrhages and how many microaneurysms. So there is a tool that we published in that paper, that so-called DREAM tool, diabetic retinopathy analysis tool using machine learning. So that goes through the process. So I won't go through a lot of that. We are continuing that work with respect to other things, such as optical coherence tomography images in diabetic macular edema, as well as age-related macular degeneration, AMD. And we are trying to find how to segment these OCT images such that we can find fluids in the, or cysts or fluids inside the eye. And using those fluids, then we can say who has diabetic macular edema or age-related macular edema. So we are looking at those kinds of things. So let me quickly jump into the last topic of DNA computing. So as we began thinking about how to compute signal processing operations such as digital filters, fast Fourier transforms, or any kind of DSP operation through the DNA computing, the most important bottleneck that we came across is how do you have a delay element in this DNA computing system? Because every signal processing operation needs to have a delay element. The delay element serves two things. Either one, it stores the value, or it stores and transfers. So what was so-called X2, sample number 2, for a time series X, right now, as the new sample comes in, X3, then X2 goes to the output of a delay element. So those of you who do DSP clearly know we need these delay elements. Delay elements are clocked by clocks. So where is a clock in a DNA computing system? So we need the notion of a chemical clock. And so Hua Jiang, who worked on this for his PhD thesis, came up with a scheme, so-called RGB scheme. So we have three different proteins, the red protein, and the green protein, and the blue protein. So if you think about the red protein, there are two states of red proteins, the presence and the absence. There are two proteins, red present, red absent, green present, green absent, and blue present and blue absent. So we begin to transfer R to G, G to B, and B to R. So think about the absence of blue. So while blue protein is absent, it triggers the transfer of the red protein to the green protein, and it, protein transfer goes on. So some red has transferred to green, and after a little while, all the red has been transferred to green. And then when the red protein all has been transferred and we call that the absence of red protein, that triggers the transfer of green to blue. And then that transfer continues. After a little while, the transfer is complete. And then the green becomes absent. The absent green triggers blue to red. And transfer continues, and after that transfer is done. So at that point, we have completed a computational cycle. So when the transfer of red to green, green to blue, and blue to red is complete, we call that a clock period or a computational period. So using that as a clock, then we can compute digital filters, fast Fourier transforms, all in DNA strand. So this is showing an example of the top signal is showing a mixture of two sinusoids, one low frequency and one high frequency, and going through an averaging filter, simple two-tap averaging filter, the DNA computing system has in fact filtered out the high frequency component. So the last part that I'm going to talk about is how to compute machine learning functions such as tangent hyperbolic and logistic regression functions or artificial neural networks using DNA computing. So there is a paradigm, so-called stochastic computing paradigm, in the digital computing literature, where, for example, instead of having a binary representation, we have a unary representation. So each bit, one or zero, has the same weight. So if I have 10 bits to represent a number, shown here 10110100011, and out of these 10 bits, these are unary, each one has same weight, and the six out of these 10 are ones. That means the value of the number is 6 by 10, or 0.6. Now, the idea of translating that knowledge from stochastic computing to molecular computing is that if we, instead of thinking about these ones and zeros as one by one input to a digital computing system in a clock cycle, let's grab all the one bits and call that concentration A1. A1 is a protein that has concentration proportional to ones. And let's collect all the zeros, four zeros, and call that another protein A0. A0 concentration represents a percent of zeros. So in this case, the value of the concentration A, by the fractional coding, the molecule A is encoded using two molecules, A1 and A0, so that A1 by A0 plus A1 is the concentration of A. So now, with that knowledge, we can take any stochastic computing block diagram or architecture, and then translate that to a molecular computing system or a DNA computing system. So to give you a simple example, on the right-hand side, we have a stochastic multiplier that computes A times B, and in this case, it shows that the AND gate outputs one if both are ones. And at the end, the proportional of output ones will be the proportion of the input ones for both A and B. Okay, so then how do I take that AND gate and put that into a DNA reaction? Well, if you look at the bottom left block diagram called a multiplier that computes A times B equal to C, so we have now A encoded into two fractional molecules, A0 and A1. B has been encoded into B0 and B1. So the C equal to A times B in the digital AND gate is equivalent to the molecular reaction A1 plus B1 goes to C1. If one molecule of A1 and one molecule of B1 combine to get one molecule of C1, that is essentially saying if A is 1 and B is 1, then you create C is equal to 1. And otherwise, C is 0 for all other things. The right-hand NAND gate is also mapped to molecular reactions. That shows that A1 plus B1 goes to C0. So that's computing 1 minus A times B. So these MALT and NMALT, multiplier and not multiplier, so if we can then map these into molecular reactions, then every computation in stochastic computing that can be mapped into AND and NAND gates can be mapped into DNA strands. So to go through one example, if I want to compute e to the power minus x, and by a Maclaurin series expansion, that can be written as 1 minus x plus x squared by factorial 2 and so on. And if I go through a Horner's rule expansion of that, then what we have here is an equivalent representation only using NAND gates. So you can see that x by 4 times 1 minus x by 5, 1 minus that is a NAND gate, and then 1 minus that 1 minus that, there are 4 NAND gates. So in this case, using these NAND gates, we can compute e to the power minus x. But each of these NAND or AND gates can be mapped to the molecular computing system by those reactions, equivalent molecular reactions using fractional coding. So there are all these tan hyperbolic, sigmoid, all kinds of functions can be mapped to NAND gate or AND gate using stochastic logic, and that's a paper that I published, just went on IEEE Explore last week, and you can go to that paper to see how that's done in stochastic computing, and from that we can map that directly to DNA strands. So, and that's work by your colleague here, George Sillig, and Eric Winfrey at Caltech. So the last part here is computing an artificial neural network using DNA computing. Here we have these x1 through xn are inputs, which are binary inputs in this case, ones and zeros. The weights are not binary, and we are computing the weighted sum of those binary streams plus a bias going through the sigmoid function and computing a result. So this shows the DNA reaction of that computation in MATLAB and using molecular computing. And we can see that the molecular reactions, in fact, lead to the same results. And by the way, this is showing a clone of a physical unclonable function, which is another project we are working on in hardware security. And in this case, the goal was to show that we can do physical unclonable functions in DNA as well. So that was the motivation for that. So with that, I'm going to briefly talk about the collaborators, numerous collaborators, Dr. Tom Henry from neurology, and he's the director of the epilepsy clinic, current student Zhiseng Zhang. And there have been many psychiatrists and students from psychiatry and ophthalmology collaborator, Dr. Kuja Kanani, who is an eye surgeon in the clinic, and former student who is professor now here in University of Washington, Bethel, number of students and collaborators, including Professor Riddle and current students. So that's kind of, that concludes my talk. So I'm going to stop here.
We have time for a few questions. Chris?
So I have a question. There were some interesting things in there on the ratio of the theta band to the alpha band. So that, I guess, ultimately became a classifier of some sort. Is there any physical explanation for why one band goes down and one band goes up, and from a more of a, I guess, neurophysiological perspective?
Well, the question was, why does the ratio feature become more discriminatory for classification, and what is the physical significance or the biological significance of why one power in certain band goes up or certain band goes down? And that's what we are trying to understand, and that's a great question, and I don't have an answer to that, but I think we need to get into modeling of neuronal populations and try to understand why the band powers increase or decrease. And so one thing that I have thought of, and we haven't done that yet, is to go to something like the Hodgkin-Huxley model and try to play with the parameters and see why the band power increases, what is happening with respect to the firing rate. And so we certainly can relate. And I do believe it is possible to relate the biological phenomena that causes that, but we have not answered that yet. Great question, though.
Other questions? Anyone else?
So I found the clock rather interesting, cycling through the three stage. Is there any sense on how stable that process is, or both to sort of environmental effects as well as within itself in terms of the equivalent of jitter, for example?
You are talking about the red, green, blue. So in the DNA, so the question was the stability and the effectiveness of the RGB clock. So definitely, that's pretty challenging. So I don't want to say it's pretty stable. I mean, it's pretty challenging because if you look at the RGB clock, these transfers So in chemistry, the rate of reaction is proportional to the concentration. As this green is going to blue and the green quantity is decreasing, the reaction rate is slowing down. And so that means we need positive feedback to enhance that rate as the reactant amount goes down. So if we don't play with these kinds of positive feedback, eventually the clock will die down. So I think what we have here seems to be working, but that's certainly that the red, green, blue clock stability is definitely something one needs to do more about. And it may die down still after a few days, I'm not sure, or maybe after a month. But this certainly was a proof of concept that it can be done, and you can do DSP inside a test tube.
Yes.
You've talked about different ways of stimulating the brain, charge, electricity, sound. Have you looked at other ways like meditation or pranayama and how that stimulates the brain, fMRI as well as the fMRI and so on?
The question was how about stimulating the brain as opposed to magnet and electricity and sound through meditation and some of those things. Indeed, Kelvin Lim, who is a psychiatrist in my university, has been doing a lot of experiments and publishing papers on the effect of yoga on these psychiatric population and subjects with PTSD who come to VA. So I have not looked at that, but definitely without doubt, there is modulation going on. And I'm glad you asked that question, because that's certainly we need to understand more with respect to the quantitative analysis of the brain connectivity. That's a great question. I have not looked at. Kelvin Lim is working on that. But yes, I mean, I think there is interest in that.
DNA means unique, right? So itself is, I guess, it can be used to identify. Can you try to develop some kind of device that can be used?
No, the DNA is, I didn't get into a lot of that, but the DNA is an identifier for human beings. But in the context of synthetic biology, if you have a certain DNA, if you know about physical unclonable functions, which is based on challenge and response, and you have a DNA strands inside a test tube that are responding to a certain challenge. So that's a physical unclonable function in a test tube as opposed to in a circuit, in an integrated circuit. And that the result of that response is now read by a sensor from the DNA test tube and is now in a signature. So that's the intent of that work. But what I showed was not that. What I showed was not giving challenges and computing response, but rather cloning an integrated circuit puff and showing that it can be done in DNA. So that's emulating a puff in the DNA. And that's kind of, an intermediate goal, but not the end goal. Not the end goal. The end goal is still waiting for us to prove.
How to evaluate or test the effect or efficiency of the machine learning in your research?
The question was, how do we study or quantify the effectiveness of the machine learning research? Well, the effectiveness comes from analyzing sensitivity, specificity, and not just the and area under curve, AUC. So those are all, of course, standard machine learning features. But we are also looking at the effectiveness to which it can be implemented in chips. So we are looking at the power consumption of the classifier and the feature extractors. So there is a lot of myth, that just taking hundreds and hundreds of features or thousands of support vectors is not necessarily, it may be giving rise to the best classifier result, but that's not great, because if we have to implement these in chips, the power consumption or the energy consumption would be a lot. So we also have to be mindful of having low false positives and high sensitivity, but also computational simplicity. And that is what I did not talk about today, how the machine learning research impacts design of low energy classifiers and low energy feature extractors. And that's not something I discussed today.
Any other questions? Yes, back there.
In the seizure classification, did you change the temporal or time bins or resolution of the classification, and how did that contribute to the, or change the accuracy of a band ratio-based features?
The question was if we change the temporal resolution. So that's probably a difficult question to answer. No, we didn't change anything. I mean, we were looking at 4 seconds with 50% overlap. So that means effectively we are computing a new feature every 2 seconds. So that was true for interictal, preictal, and so in fact, that's, so yeah, no, we are not changing anything. So if you look at the block diagram of that system, so that's, so we do the window operation, we compute the power spectral density in band 1 and band 2 and take the ratio, do some post-processing. So that's done at effective frame period of 2 seconds, 4 seconds with 50% overlap.
Any questions? All right, let's thank the speaker.
Thank you.